like to shimmy and shake. My baby, she like to hesitate. My baby, she likes to rock a while. My baby, she likes to rock and style. So let's rock.
Rock and roll is a river of music, which has absorbed many streams. Rhythm and blues, jazz, ragtime, cowboy songs, country songs, folk songs, all have contributed greatly to the big beat. And here's a young man who's come out of the country field to join us rock and rollers. Johnny Burnett singing Lonesome Train.
When people don't know what rockabilly is, I ask them if they know what Elvis sounds like, and I go from there.
Rockabilly came from originally hillbilly music, basically, so anything that's like down home, got that rootsy kind of feeling, it can fall into all those genres, right, between country blues or rockabilly.
You take an old Johnny Cash song or you take an old Hank Williams song and you play it 100 miles an hour, and that would be a nutshell description of it.
In one big pack.
White guys listening to a lot of black music, race records and whatnot, and you know, it's definitely a mix of country music and certainly some blues as well, and it's sort of adapted into this sort of rock and roll sound, which is a big strong blues backbeat with sort of honky tonk changes.
Just original roots rock and roll, the very bare bones, you know, a singer, guitar, drums and a bass, and get just going at it.
I find it hard when people call like pure rockabilly, because it's not a pure thing, it's a blend of things, and it's a great mix. It's the most primal form of rock and roll that I've ever heard.
And there's so many aspects of it now, right, from the whole traditional Western swing rockabilly right to the whole kind of you know, psychobilly thing, and then there's a whole edgy kind of metal psychobilly thing. So. And it's rock and roll music, and it's all based in the 50s, but it's all the same thing. It's just tarted up here and there.
To me, it's all interconnected anyway, so I mean, all that stuff is totally all part and parcel of what rockabilly is.
Forever traveling, I'm on a lonesome train, on a lonesome train.
Rockabilly was the punk rock of the 50s, you know. It was the first really rebellious art form.
It was traditionally an underground music inspired by blues, and my vision of it is like these hicks down in Kentucky.
They kind of wanted to play rhythm and blues music, which was pretty daring, you know, in the South. Like, and I, you know, I've heard this from certain guys, you know, like, that it was kind of dangerous for them to do this. So it's kind of the original punk rock in a way.
Elvis was the real deal. And they commercialized him, and that's not his fault. And he's Elvis, he's the king. But his early stuff was rockabilly. You can go and dig deeper and find Carl Perkins or
Jerry Lee Lewis, Sonny Burgess, Sleepy LaBeef. Obviously, Gene Vincent is probably my favorite singer of that whole era.
You get Gene Vincent or the Johnny Burnett trio?
Johnny Burnett, probably. This is Robert Gordon, Link Wray.
You know, Big Joe Turner and all those groups and stuff were playing rock and roll basically before the term was kind of coined, so.
Well, I'd say they'd have to get a big pot and throw a bunch of country and a bunch of blues and then hillbillies in there. And then you'd get a rockabilly stew, I think.
Rockabilly is about angst and sex and cars.
A lot of people were just strictly all about the rockabilly, and that's fine because I love it, especially the hot guys with the hot cars.
And the cars, well, I mean, the cars were totally rock and roll back in those days. You wanted to be ostentatious. You know, you wanted everybody to see you driving down the street and hard to skip a beat from the, you know, the overall image of you with your quiff and your hot car. And it definitely flatters the whole culture, you know.
The hot rodding thing really came about when people came back from the war. These people were flying planes, driving jeeps, you know, riding motorbikes, shooting Nazis, you know, and they came back and they just wanted freedom. And at the same time, GM as a payment, or the big three, for building tanks and stuff in the war, the whole freeway infrastructure was built to kind of repay the auto companies so that they would sell cars. And at the same time, all these GIs that now had jobs working on the roads and stuff and wanted the freedom that they'd gotten, they weren't just from small town Ohio anymore. They had the money and the means to get everywhere, and all these beautiful cars were built for the roads. The old tradition was a pre-1949 or even pre-war stripped down car made lighter by taking the fenders, any external parts off, and more horsepower for racing. Custom cars were more finished, usually later model cars with comfortable interiors and everything that you could take your girlfriend on a date with.
Me, it's more show than go, you know? I mean, it's gotta look good, because I don't really need to go fast as long as I can go slow and everyone looks at me.
You drop the front, you paint it black, you put in big pipes and big tires. You got a hot rod. It's all in the attitude, I think.
It's also nice to see a burnout and smoke fill the neighborhood. That's a hot rod, you know. Well, this is a 55 Buick Special that I got last November from an old timer up in Pemberton. And it was pretty rusty at the time. So, he was glad to see it go. It's got the original motor. Everything, it sounds great, right? We had to cut through the frame to get the dual exhaust up underneath so it's not dragging on the ground, because it wasn't designed for dual, just had a single exit. So we moved the master cylinder over underneath, which is attached to the frame. We stuck the exhaust through that hole, cut another hole for the new master cylinder, and there you go, almost done.
I am a biggest car snob you'll meet. Never once have I bought a car just because it was a car. I drive Chevs. I drive Chev two doors and only particular ones. When I bought the 49, it was that car that I wanted. I've got a picture of me at age one sanding the identical car, custom with no door handles and everything, for my dad. And the hearse. I always wanted a hearse. And that is the most beautiful hearse I could find. That car is a 59 Impala, two-door hardtop, 348 tri-power, three-speed overdrive. The handles are shaved, the front end's dropped, there's air shocks in the back. It's blanked, which means you took the chrome off the front and blanked it out. It's got a Buick interior, which has now been trashed because I drive it every day.
Well, this is a 1962 Ford Galaxy 500. I got this in December off an elderly fellow in my area that I live out in Delta, BC. It came without the door handles in the back. It used to be four doors, but it only has the two now. And the gentleman had recessed the antenna and done a few things to it. I've done the interior of the car myself, and my friend Pat just did the scallops on it this week.
Kind of labor intensive. My friend busted out his airbrush and kind of added some oranges and yellows and different colors into the flames to make it stand out. The job was started on a Monday, done on a Thursday night. Probably in all, it was about 20 hours to do and $50.
The flame job took 40 hours to tape off. It's as good as a flame job gets. I believe that came from World War II bomber designs.
Flames and hot rods go hand in hand, like bread and butter. It's just like, when you see a car with flames on it, you know that it means this means shit, you know? They're not fucking around.
The way they look really cool. Especially with dice in them, so. Yeah. That's pretty much. And the flames, yeah.
Back then, cars are made of steel, they're built to last, they had a lot of style. Modern cars are pretty much all the same looking, made of plastic, and you bump into something at 10 miles an hour and the whole thing's all screwed up.
You know, the cars were cooler, the women were better looking, the music was better.
Growing up, I was listening to Elvis and all the old school music, and I just loved the era. I loved the 50s. There's something about it, it's glamorous and very well put together. Everybody's so pretty.
It just looks good, and it's glamorous, and it's stylish and classy, and you know that's what appeals to me, and I think it appeals to a lot of other people as well.
People are drawn to it because it represents a simpler or a more straightforward era. For example, women weren't afraid to take pride in their appearance. Maybe it sounds really trite, but you know, men were men and women were women. And
even if you were a housewife, you were always dolled up. You woke up at 5 o'clock in the morning, just do your hair, put a dress on, put the shoes on, and make sure, you know, the meal was still on the table, but you still looked really damn good.
People now don't spend nearly as much time getting to all that, but making, like, putting the effort into themselves. Like, I like spending a good 45 minutes doing my hair and my makeup and putting on eyelashes and looking in the mirror, and I look like a little, like, art piece.
Yeah. Like, the men are putting time into their cars, the women are putting time into their hair and makeup.
Not like girls nowadays, they actually look like Rita Hayworth and Betty Page and Marilyn Monroe. And the guys in the bands had the best looking girls. So I thought, well, I want to be in a rockabilly band. Yeah, it was the love of music, but I can't lie, it was also for the girls.
Tasteful form of striptease. It's done in a very classy way because, you know, with the rockabilly scenes, it's all about nostalgia and, you know, punk rock's about, like, doing your own thing, right? So it kind of submerged and, you know, girls got together, started doing these shows and trying to recreate this old style of striptease.
Going to the root of the word, burl actually means to make fun of, so burlesquing something means making fun of something, and usually in a naughty way. But probably people think of today is the kind of 50s stripteasy golden era stuff. The old pinup pictures brought to life. Fan dancing, bumping and grinding, the shimmy. When you couldn't show it all, you know, way back then you'd have to, you know, do the very suggestive movements.
Started at sort of at the turn of the century. I'd say it would be pretty boring back then because, I mean, if you showed an ankle, that was really risque. So I think it peaked in the 30s and 40s when there was actual burlesque circuits around North America and people were able to tour huge theaters. It was known as the Poor Man's Follies, when all the beautiful, talented girls went off to do the Ziegfeld Follies on Broadway. All the not so good looking, not so talented girls who are just trying to make money because, you know, the war era and whatnot, they went into burlesque. But it became really popular because, you know, just regular people would go in and pay, like, you know, probably a dollar or whatever to see a show, and they would do little striptease, they'd have an orchestra, they'd have comedians. It was a full show. I think a lot of the burlesque shows that happen now are based more on the 50s era and 50s style of burlesque. Just rock and roll, like stand-up bass, baritone sax, you know, just guitar, like a little singer doing a little mashed potato or whatever. And then you have the girl come out in her glittery outfit and doing a little, you know, striptease, and a lot of the tassel twirling, which was more common than it was in the past, because like I said, nudity was not acceptable in the 20s and 30s.
I believe there's more class in burlesque than there is in stripping. I would never do the full strip.
I always get complimented, like they say, oh wow, this is very classy, it's not like stripping, it's not raunchy, and you know, that's kind of what I'm going for, and I think that's what the appeal is.
Your typical variety burlesque show is strip teasers, comics, singers,
musicians,
specialty acts.
It involves a lot of nostalgia and the whole aesthetic of vintage style. I preferably like the 50s. There's more color and glitter, and I'm really big on costuming and makeup.
The difference between strippers and burlesque dancers is that strippers make money and burlesque dancers just spend all their money on costumes.
The costume I had was the poodle skirt. I'm not the glam, pretty, sparkle kind of girl. Instead of putting a poodle on it, I put a skull in all glitter and sequins, and it was awesome. I like to throw a little trash in there too. I originally was going to do something else, completely different than what I did, and it was more like a 1930s look, and I just kind of realized that it wasn't me. I can't put it together. I'm going to look like a complete idiot. I got to stick to what I know and who I am, and that's more of the 50s style. I was so nervous. Oh my goodness, I was so nervous. I was sitting in here and listening to my iPod, playing the song over and over and over again, and right before I got on stage, all the anxiety and the nervousness just kind of went away, and I heard the crowd cheering, and it gives you this huge rush. Holy cow, that's gonna be me. They're gonna be clapping for me. And I was really excited. I think it went horrible. I got so carried away. I was trying to do a song that had the least amount of music playing. That way I didn't have to be sitting there shaking my boobs to absolutely nothing. And the song was actually too short. I got on stage and I just gave her hell, and I got kind of carried away, and I saw my friend in the front row who was practicing with me the night before, and he kept pointing to my top, like, take it off, take it off. I'm like, oh shit, the song's almost over. I whip off my top and the song was done, but it worked. It was okay, nobody noticed, I'm sure.
I'm not a professional dancer, and that's the beauty of burlesque, because I think burlesque is very forgiving. You know, there's just not a lot of judgment, and it's a great way to explore like other hidden talents you might have. It's not Broadway, it's burlesque, so you can kind of do whatever you want. And someone once said to me, with burlesque, if it's good, it's great. If it's bad, it's still good. So that's kind of the motto. As far as I know, rockabilly in Vancouver, I would go see Ray Kondo a lot. The Railway was like my home base. There was a time that was kind of like a place for people to go, and they know that, you know, they knew they could go there and, you know, hear rockabilly bands. And
when I moved out west, I'd known of Ray Kondo for a long time, and I ended up meeting Ray and becoming good friends with Ray and his band, Pete Turland and Steve Taylor and Steve McLeave and Jimmy Roy. And through those guys, that's been pretty much where I've really got a chance to really explore what I like to do.
When I was in a band called the Nervous Fellas, it was like, we were playing, Harold Nix Band was playing, it was the Rockin' Fools, which Jimmy Roy was in, from Ray Kondo's band. And there was the Stingin' Hornets with a great singer named Howard Ricks, who still performs occasionally.
It was really fun, and it was a good little scene happening in Vancouver back then. It was lots of clubs, lots of work. We ended up We ended up playing in Seattle and places like that, but more just for fun. It wasn't like we really needed to. There was plenty of work in Vancouver.
It was very good, and it was very open, and it was a very open scene. People from all different kinds of, you know, backgrounds and whatever interests would show up at these gigs.
There's so many talented people here. There's always a root scene here, and that's where it comes out of.
I think Vancouver's got a really good scene. It's a small scene, as any kind of roots rockabilly scene is usually quite small, but I think it's really dedicated here. Like, it hasn't really died out. Like, other cities I've lived in, you know, it sort of comes and goes. It's consistent here. There's been a scene here since, you know, since the mid-80s, and I'm sure before that as well.
Because rockabilly has been kind of like a sheltered existence in Canada for a lot of years. It's like always a really small cult following. I think right now it's kind of getting bigger, though. There's a lot more people getting into it. It's nice to see.
There's always going to be young women who are going to be interested in the style, the aesthetic, you know, the nostalgia of burlesque, and it's going to keep coming back. And honestly, when you mix girls, music, and striptease, it's, you know, and alcohol, it's never going to go out of style.
I mean, it's actually, it's almost like we live in an era where people just kind of pick little pieces of the 20th century that they like.
I've got my guitar, my leather jacket, my cowboy boots, and my girlfriend. That's all I need.
It'd be a blast to be able to get in a time capsule and go back and go hear some of that music when it was happening, you know? That would be the greatest thing in the world.
The music that came out in that era was rock and roll, and what the kids were driving back then were hot rods, and it kind of goes hand in hand, you know, nowadays, and people want to relive that cool generation.
It's a lifestyle that you get into, and it becomes your life. It becomes who you are.
You know, it sort of used to be a lifestyle for me. I used to have the old cars, and I always greased up, and I always had the leather jacket on. And for me, it's more about just digging the music, you know, like in the energy. And really, that's the most important thing about the music, is the energy of the music.
Simple, youthful, beautiful stuff, honest. And that's what real rockabilly is like, anyway, it's honest music.
So, I mean, it's always there. There's so much good stuff there that people keep mining it. They keep, and they always will. They're going to go back to it and back to it, because that's where rock and roll came from.